Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Alamance County Commissioners, and before we begin, I would like to go to the Lord in prayer. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for all the blessings you bestow on us. Thank you, God, for all the men that are in this room today that actually work to protect us and make us safe. And God, just be with them. Protect all law enforcement across this country and protect them as they go about their daily duties, and just put your loving angels upon them. And God, thank you for this board, and I ask your wisdom this morning as we go about our agenda and make it be the right choice in your eyes. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
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 Let's
do it. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. All right, this morning we have no one on our agenda for public speaking, so our next order of business would be commissioner responses, so I don't guess they have to respond to anything. So. All right, first thing, I would like to ask for approval of the agenda. Any amendments?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, very good. Consent agenda. Is there anything on there that someone might want to pull to discuss?
I move approval of the consent agenda.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? We don't have none. So, all right. Sheriff, I think you're up. Up to bat.
Good morning, Commissioners. It's an honor to be here this morning. The emergency service personnel of the county, a lot of them will be presenting briefly this morning some of the things, but never in the history of this country has training been more important in law enforcement in this nation. Problems that we're encountering many times in this nation, people getting killed, some of this possibly could have been prevented with the proper training, and it is very important right now, I think, to the communities and to this nation that we try to put on the best possible training for law enforcement officers and emergency personnel. I'm appearing before you this morning along with several other people that you see here to talk about the possibility of looking into developing a training center, regional training center here in Alamance County for all emergency personnel. All we're looking for today is just the approval of the concept to be able to put something down on paper to look at cost. There are a few people that I've talked to in the very early stages when we talked about Sachs Paul that's willing to come forward and put in some of the work at zero cost. I would like that opportunity to be able to look into this. This in no way has anything to do with the actual building of the training center other than just being able to look into the cost and what we're going to do. So, just giving an example, the sheriff's office, since I've become sheriff, has 132,796 hours in training, and we needed much more. But because of our budget, and these other departments are the same way, because they're training budgets, some of this training was not possible. If we were to develop a regional training center, a lot of these schools where we're having to send people out to Las Vegas, and I know y'all say Las Vegas, well, that's the cheapest hotels you can get. That's why the training, the major trainings in this country are at places like that. We could bring those to Alamance County. And all of our officers wouldn't have to travel, wouldn't have to pay hotel and meals, could do it right here in Alamance County through our college. And you will be hearing from Vice President of Workforce Development, Gary Saunders, and President Dr. Alistair Gatewood shortly. But at this time, I would like to do a brief PowerPoint to show you what we've done so far. Okay, overview emergency service training and available facilities. Daily, our emergency services, law enforcement, fire, EMS respond to a wide variety of calls for service. These calls may be a routine as a stranded motorist on the interstate or as serious as a fully involved house fire or traffic accidents where victims are pinned in or even homicides, rapes, etc. as far as law enforcement. The common thread in all these calls is training, folks. And I'm telling you, it is imperative that we receive the best training. All emergency services require training to offer our citizens the highest level of service, no matter how routine or serious a call may be. Training comes into all these, regardless of the seriousness of the call. Single's greatest liability for emergency service is inadequate training. Now, currently our level of training is adequate, but that is not good enough. It is when I say good enough, we have got to do more training. Our law enforcement and emergency service personnel, our society is demanding that. We need it to be above adequate. Current facilities, county leases property from the state on Boggs Ranch Road, which our agency uses firearms range. The college uses its firearm range too for basic law enforcement. There are no restroom facilities, no running water, no classrooms. But further, the state has recently notified us this property has been declared surplus and will be listed for sale. This leaves us with no available facility to perform state-mandated firearms qualification. And our people have to do night and day qualification twice a year, along with the other agencies in the county that use this range. EMS and Rescue currently have no designated training facilities.
How many acres is that, Terry?
Yes, sir.
How many acres is that?
Boggs
Ranch. The Boggs Ranch have what, about probably less than 5 acres.
Okay.
Less than 5 acres. Yeah. I mean, it's very small because it's really down. It's really not viable for what we do, but we have to have somewhere to try to do it. Current facility, City of Burlington currently owns a police and fire training center that is equipped with a classroom, driving pad, and firearms range. Currently, Burlington Police Department does not permit use of firearms range by other agencies. However, they have been good. The driving pad and classroom are utilized by every agency in the county and Alamance Community College basic and advanced law enforcement training classes. A portion of this facility is also open when available to our volunteer fire department. The problem is we have so many agencies and Burlington has so many people that they are using these facilities and we cannot always get access to them. And they've been good to us with what we can have, when we can use it. But they have the responsibility to their department first. State maintains two law enforcement training facilities in Salemburg, Sampson County, and Edneyville, Henderson County. Training at these facilities result in one-way travel, 2.5 hours to one and 3.5 hours respectively to other. The problem there is they set a schedule. Training schedule, and it may not be the training topics that your people need. It may just be basic training that maybe the officers already had. And the travel time and having to stay, etc., causes some problems for our agencies. Why a training facility in Alamance County? We're looking at the green level area. Martin Marietta has agreed to lease at a very, very, very nominal cost to us, a 90-acre plot of land. Now, to start off with, we won't need the full 90 acres. However, you will see the drawing that the architect has done to just show us. They have looked at all the building permits. They've looked at the mining permits. They've looked at everything that we need to be able to start looking at the possible cost of that facility. The reason, ease of scheduling for local agencies. It will be a big enough site that we will be able to schedule agencies where we're not having to hold off if we need something done. Two or three agencies could honestly come together if the facility's big enough to do training. Reduction of travel, reduction of overtime costs, monetary benefits to the county economy, benefits to ACC, and offer quality training. We have talked to ACC about actually taking the program over, and they are here. Dr. Gatewood is here to talk with you shortly. The interstate corridor will allow us to market a facility on a regional concept, which means money will come into Alamance County versus our money going to Salemburg or somewhere else. Reduction on demand of the Burlington's facility will certainly be created. Creation of additional space to provide for more training opportunities. Preliminary work today. The concept has the support of the county police and fire chiefs. A lot of them are here, and all of them won't be speaking, but they're here because they understand, just like we do, the importance of training to our officers and to the for the public. Martin Marietta has agreed to lease the county 90 acres of property at a site on Highway 49 North in Green Level. Town of Green Level has agreed to provide water and sewer infrastructure. Engineering studies on the site have determined proposed facilities to be environmentally safe and capable of withstanding a firearms range, driving pad, and classroom. Now, there's different phases that you'll look in just a minute. We're talking about a fire tower. We're going to cover all emergency services in this county. This will be their training center. The engineering firm of Withers and Revenow have drawn preliminary plans of the layout of what a proposed facility may look like. You have phase one, which will be our firearms range and a rifle range and the driving track. The driving track will be 500 by 600 feet. The pistol range will be 100 by 100 feet. And the rifle range will be 300 by 100 feet. These are important things. All emergency personnel will be able to drive and use this track, which will help the county probably in not paying for wrecks and insurance. The first phase is an imperative that we're going to have our rifle range and pistol range. Okay, there is a range tower there. Then we're looking at phase two, and I hope I can hit all of them. You're looking at a tower here. Also, you're looking at parking here with classrooms, a fire tower where the fire departments will train. That's all fire departments. Not just the city fire departments, but the volunteer county fire department will be in phase two of it. Going forward, to date, there are no construction drawings to provide cost estimate. Phase one of the project and the most immediate need is construction of the handgun and rifle ranges and the driving track, which is due to the existing range lease that we're going to have a problem with firearms. That's a major thing right now. As indicated, future phases include addition of driving pad, classroom building, fire tower, a search and rescue area, which would be the remaining of the acreage of the 90 acres, which would probably be about 45 acres there, and a canine training facility. Alamance Community College has agreed to offer the instructional training component necessary to support the center. I will tell you, here in Alamance County, we are very fortunate that our emergency services and the college works together so good. And I feel like that if we can get this training center, you will see an improvement in the services of all emergency first services in the county. At this time, I'm going to ask Gary Saunders, Vice President of Workforce Development, to come up.
Welcome, Gary.
Good morning, Chairman and Commissioners. I appreciate the opportunity to speak before you. I'm not good at this, so bear with me. But I think there's a PowerPoint. Maybe not. Okay.
There was. We've got it on our.
There we go. What I want to talk to you about is we provide the instruction for the center. We train both curriculum and for credit and non-credit at the college. The difference is curriculum, is like I said, is for the curriculum college that get a degree. Some of the training we do for law enforcement, EMS, and the fire departments, they need certifications, but they don't get a college credit, so to speak. They get CDUs or ACUs for the credit, but this is mandated, 24 hours are mandated every year for law enforcement. You have mandated law training for the EMS. The county does an excellent job with the EMS training, and you pay these people to get so many hours of training. Plus, a lot of them come on their own. Law enforcement, like I said, has mandated 24 hours of training each year. And each of these departments, I will tell you this, every time that there's been a national crisis of something where it involves a police department or a police officer, these chiefs and the sheriff have always worked to be proactive and to meet these head on. They develop training, we provide the training, but they work with us to develop what type of training they need. The driving training, as the sheriff said, is something we need because it does help with the insurance. We take BLET students out to the track. We show them how to drive, how to handle a car, how to handle emergency responses. The ambulance drivers, they take a truck out. The fire departments, they take a truck out on the pad. There's all types of training that's necessary for these people. If you have a wreck on I-85, chances are you're going to get an Alamance Community College student out there, either the policeman, the fireman, or EMS, or maybe all three is going to be from have a graduate of our college. And we're proud of that. And we want these students to be able to do what's necessary to save my life, your life, or whomever it may be out there. I think we do an excellent job. I think the sheriff can attest to it, and she smites, and all the chiefs can tell you that we work together as a team. The county, Ryan and Craig worked with his EMS. I think we work excellent with the fire departments. John can tell you about that. But we work, this county, you don't realize it, I'm new to this county. I've never seen such agencies work so well together. I don't see the egos that I have in other counties. They think more about what's good for the county. And the school will support with instruction. We can pay for it with the dollars we earn from the state for the instruction. But I think this is a good thing for the county. I think it's a good thing for the college because we're willing to do the instruction. Yes, sir.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
Sure.
You know, the Alamance Burlington school system is considering the use of Graham High School as sort of a trade school, and which would include a lot of public service training, such as first responders, maybe EMTs, maybe fire training, firefighting. Do you see this facility interfacing with that notion at
Yes,
all?
Yes, sir, because I think what they can get in high school, they have to carry on forward, and there are mandated training that they would have to have later on. That's the first step in getting a career. They will have to enhance the career, maybe go and get a two-year degree in criminal justice, go and get a two-year degree in EMS. But these things, we work together as a team. It's not an individual asset at all. It's what we can do for the betterment of our students and get them in the right career path. We will have firemen. We will have police officers in this county. Last year at this time, there was a reduction in people wanting to be a police officer. We had a waiting list this time for people wanting to get into basic law enforcement training, which is, if you look across the state, that's not happening. There's a demand for police officers, and there's people getting out of it because of the media and so forth, the way they're portrayed. But we have good people in this county wanting to be police officers, wanting to be EMS, wanting to be firemen, so we need to enhance that with our training skills.
I have a question. You say community colleges offer free training, tuition waivers for qualified public safety personnel. Would there be a distinction for the free training, tuition waivers between in-county agencies or emergency services agencies and out-of-county emergency services?
The way the fee waiver works is across the state. If a sworn officer in North Carolina, they get free training. If they associated with the EMS agency or fire agency, they get free training in the related fields. Now, they don't get to take a history class because they're a fireman or anything. But to enhance their skills across the state, there is a fee waiver no matter which college they go to. So, in essence, we can get anyone across the state here to enhance their training.
And you get credits for those
people
that come in?
We earn FT from that. and that's how we earn our money. We earn approximately $5,000 for each FTE, which is 688 hours for one person or 10 people.
Coming to the community college.
Yes, sir.
Where's that money come from?
The state.
From the state?
Yes.
Okay, and that's for things that are under the curriculum for credit? If it's continuing education, not for credit, does the same
it's just waiver either way. The difference being is for curriculum, it's 512 hours for one FTE. For the curriculum side, it's 688 hours. But they're looking at prioritizing that in the state, so it may change later on. But we still earn FTE for that. But the main thing is, no matter what's curriculum or continuing ed, we still provide the quality training needed for the skills.
But that's a cost that's not borne by the community college itself. It's borne by the state. So it's free to the people who are participating, but it's not free. So somebody has to pay for it. So the money's coming from the state, not from the county. Is
yes.
that right?
Yes, and there is part of the training, like I say, is mandated. So if the state didn't pay that, the county would have to pick up the fees for the students. So it is a win-win for both the county and the state and citizens of this county.
Thanks.
Any questions? I do thank you for your time and appreciate
thank
thought
you.
On this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Probably is a question also in the commissioner's mindset. Where does Green level stand on issues, since it's going to be in a green level jurisdiction? And I'm glad to have the city manager here. It's been a great working relationship with Green level ever since I've been sheriff. And I'm going to ask Mr. Douglas to please step up.
Good morning, Mike.
Good morning.
How you doing?
Commissioners, ma'am. I wish I was a city manager, however, I'm a town administrator. I would love to be a city manager, however. Please bear with me because I am new to speaking to you all. In regards to the town of Green Level and how we view this venture is, for the most part, we support it. The reason we support it is because this is a great way for the town of Green Level to get on the map and support the county as well. This does not only support the town of Green Level, it supports the county, and that's what we're trying to do as much as possible. To be brutally honest with you, this would help Green Level out tremendously, with our tax collection rate being at 88%, 39% poverty. Putting something like this in the town of Green Level would help bring in industries and businesses as well. So my job and the county's, council's job is to promote the town of Green Level and get the economic opportunities that it can. And this is one of the things that will help us get the opportunities. Not sure what else I can say about it, but we're here to support the county as much as possible.
On the infrastructure part of it, Michael, what's involved with that? I mean, I know you guys are going to be running that part of the show, basically, getting hooked in and tied in.
With the current design of the facility, there is no problems with the infrastructure.
I mean, tying in the sewer and all that.
But yes, y'all are willing to supply the water and the sewer?
Yes, sir. We buy our water from Graham,
mm-hmm.
So that won't be an issue.
Okay.
And all of our sewer goes somewhere else. We don't treat it in the town of Green Level itself. There are current facilities. I mean, there are current amenities already in place to facilitate the structure. But I'm not going to beat around the bush with you when it comes to the infrastructure of Green Level. It needs to be improved tremendously, and that's what we're working on now.
Are the lines already down? Excuse me, Sandy Cross Road.
No, sir. That is one of the projects that I'm working on currently. Is getting water and sewer to go down the road. We've already talked to the manager in Burlington, and we're working on that now. We have an engineering company already in place to facilitate that, and we know the cost to run water and sewer down that road and hook up.
Do you have it up 49?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you have a cost estimate on what that's going to cost?
To run water and sewer
from 49 to the site, or at least to the site.
It's already there, sir.
Sir?
It's already there.
It's okay.
I thought you said the lines weren't down the road.
No, we don't have water and sewer going down Sandy Cross Road.
Well, that's what I'm talking about. From 49 down to the site, what's the estimate of that cost?
Sir, I can't tell you that off the top of my head.
No ballpark?
No, sir.
Okay. Has there been a vote of the city council on this issue?
Has there been a vote on town council?
Yes, sir.
There has been preliminary talk about the facility, and I can tell you that I have enough votes to win.
You think so?
Then support on that. So.
Sound like Craig Honeycomb.
He likes to bet on sure things, Tim.
What are the proximity of residences down that road? Because I know that back when there was a lot of blasting up there, that there were houses so close to the site that pictures were falling off the wall and plaster was cracked, foundations were cracked. Can you comment to that?
I can. Currently, there are no residential structures that are in the vicinity of the firing range. However, when the phase two is complete, you'll have a trailer park that is to the south of that that would be affected. However, because the firing range is to the north and the trailer homes are to the south, shouldn't be any impact at all.
And also with respect to Green Level, if the board does give preliminary support for this, we do have to take this project in front of their planning board to get zoning approval. So that's part of the reason for the preliminary site plan and doing some of the preliminary look at environmental issues to make sure those issues were resolved before we did take it to Green Level for their zoning approval.
And that would open it up for public input.
Absolutely,
as
sir.
To that.
Absolutely. My planning board has already seen the sketch that the sheriff sent out. I'm meeting with them again on Wednesday. So the planning board will already have a lot of knowledge before we get the full report.
Sheriff, can you bring the map up? Tim was asking questions. It might be easier if everybody could just kind of view the map to see.
Good job. That's
cool. Way to go, Sheriff.
The only thing that's going to be in effect are this park right here, Mobile Home Park.
Right.
But again, the range is all the way over here.
Okay.
There is a home that is located somewhere in this area here, but that home is going to probably be torn down because that's going to be part of the entire project itself.
Okay, so the sheriff's main entrance is coming off of 49. Is that proper?
Yes.
Okay, so that main entrance is kind of like where the rock quarry coming in point is now. Okay.
Yes, sir.
I have a couple of questions. Are the ranges enclosed? This might be a better question for the sheriff. Is noise from the firing ranges going to be an issue?
There are berms already there that Martin Marietta did because of the blasting, and we're going to probably add more to get them higher for the sound purposes. However, if you notice, the ranges are facing to the north, I think, and anytime you're it's going to go
towards those berms.
And those berms already built in front of where the ranges will be, but we're going to add dirt to them to build them up.
Would there be other like landscaping around the pad and things like that to be a noise abatement? Has that been thought about for the quality of life? Like Mr. Sutton mentioned the...
As far as the pad, that's not that much noise, not like the firearm. Mm-hmm.
Actually, noise-wise, you're going to be less than Martin Marietta blasting rock.
Absolutely,
rocks,
absolutely. So. All up there. Both ways, really.
No hand grenade throwing?
Everybody was coming last time. Mr. Commissioner said they'd be shooting from helicopters, machine guns. They aren't going to have
not going to have any of those trainings either, right?
And ma'am,
we don't have any helicopters in college, I promise you that.
We won't be back asking to buy helicopters. All that's
right.
What you're
worried about. And ma'am, if I may, I've shot at numerous ranges throughout my career in the Army. What the sheriff's told me and what I know about handguns and rifles, there's going to be minimum impact.
Great, thank you.
Very good. Any more questions, gentlemen? Okay.
Thank you very much,
Mike. Thank you for your input.
What I did, I've got two police chiefs I want to speak to you briefly. One from the smaller departments in the county, and one from the larger, and also John Payne with Fire Service and Dr. Alex Gatewood. But I'd like to start with Chief Ron Parrish from Gibsonville Police Department.
Old friend.
Hey, Ron.
Thank you, Sheriff. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, first of all, thank you guys for all your support for public safety. I know that this board has supported law enforcement in this county for many, many years, and I know you will continue to do so. I'm reminded that as a government, that our number one priority is the public safety. And in my position as chief of police, I certainly take that very seriously. And I know you guys too. You know, we live in a much different world than we did when I first got into law enforcement. And right now, training is the key. I mean, it is the key, and it can make the difference between life or death, whether it's our life or our death, or yours, or the public's that we have to serve. From a small town perspective, I have 16 police officers in the town of Gibsonville. So if I want advanced training, then I'm going to have to send them out of state, or I'm going to have to send them across the state in order to get that training. Well, when you only have two people working on a shift, that is really a burden, not only on the town, but it impacts our public's safety in the town of Gibsonville, too. If we were conducting that training here locally, if I had an emergency, then I can call that individual back and I can get them back into town and we can do whatever we need to do. You know, Alamance County has always been a leader in a lot of things. You know, whether it's our Stepping Up initiative or some of the other programs that we have. You guys have always stepped forward, took the bull by the horns, and you went charging up. We're a leader, and I think that this county is seen as a leader in a lot of areas of this state. I have, just like the sheriff, I've had the opportunity to work in many counties throughout this state. And I don't think that you'll find a law enforcement relationship any better than this one anywhere. We all work together. We all work together. We are centrally located. It would bring in, I believe, a lot of additional revenue because I believe the college would open this up for training, you know, for other agencies throughout the state. And I just, please take a look at it. And I think that I implore you to please go forward with it. Let's take a look at it. Let's see if it will work, because I do believe it will. You know, sort of like Disney World. If you build it, they're going to come. And I believe that if we build this, they're going to come. But thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to get Chief Smythe from Burlington, who has one of the largest municipal agencies here, and very, very sharp on training.
There's two handouts there. Don't mind it. I don't expect you to read them today. I believe firmly that, you know, good leaders make the very best decisions when we arm them with the facts and figures and the data that's so important to that process. So in those two handouts, the first one that you'll see is an article from Police One. It lists 25 ideas about training and maximizing the value of training. Number three on their list is to pool your resources. And that's exactly what we're going to do here, is we're going to pool our resources and make sure that we're bringing to the table the most effective mechanisms that we can to train our employees. The second document that I've shared with you is the 21st Century Policing Report. They've compartmentalized with a great deal of work over about a year period, six pillars, and the fifth pillar is training. And I've given you that entire pillar in that handout. On the top of page 52, it says, to be effective in an ever-changing world, training must continue throughout an officer's career. And that more succinctly than anything tells the tale here, that that our officers have to train year in and year out, perpetually, for excellence. And again, we do that best when we do it in a shared facility. The agency that I left in Arizona, in Navajo County, had a community college-run regional training facility that was remarkable. It wasn't built overnight. It was an incremental process, and I think that's what we're putting forth here today, is that you start the foundation, you obtain the land, and then you build it incrementally using grant funds and some government funds and some private funds, and you do so wisely and end up with a remarkable training facility. I do have extra copies of all those handouts for staff to use appropriately, so let me get through those. The last thing I'll share with you, PERF, the Police Executive Research Forum, has 30 principles on using force. The sheriff talked about saving lives and the impact that we have in what we do. No matter what your policy decision is on any one of these items, you got to implement it. You have to actually put the boots on the ground and do the training for those folks, and it really is vitally important that we do that. Lastly, I'll share with you a comment from one of the mayors that I worked for in Arizona, who said that training, at the end of a budget presentation, he said, so you're telling me, Chief, that training is like an insurance plan? I said, yeah, absolutely. You really have a pay me now or pay me later opportunity, right? One wrongful death lawsuit is going to cost whatever municipality or county is involved $1 million or more. And we don't want to have any of those negative outcomes, and we preempt that, we front load by providing appropriate professional training to all of our people at a high basis. So that's what we advocate for. The Burlington Police Department is willing to certainly lend our resources and collaborate in this process. I do get noise complaints from my range, which is why we don't open it up widely to other entities, out of deference to my citizens who don't like to hear that. And if we have a further out, more well-contained range, we would begin to use that as well. And so all of our residents would benefit from a county facility that's well-built and well-run, and we think the college and the local entities can all certainly do that. Any questions for me, folks?
On that, now, will you close your range?
I don't think we'll close it. So it's just based on proximity. It's so close and accessible to us. We envision currently having officers show up in the middle of their duty day to go do an exercise or a scenario and then immediately return to work. And that proximity is huge for us. But the most problematic shooting that we do is nighttime shooting. And so to move the night ranges a little further out of town would be fantastic for everybody involved. So I don't think we'll close ours. We'll adapt ours and morph that to be more effective for everybody involved.
Do you do driving on your facilities?
We do, sir.
Is it at the site where the guns are, or is it over by the school?
It's right by the school. Okay, so they're pretty close, so it's a tight...
Two separate spots?
It's one facility that we share with our fire department, and so we've got the range kind of in the back adjacent to the water treatment facility, and then a little closer to the shopping center is the driving track, and then immediately adjacent to that is the school.
Yeah, I'm familiar with all that. How many acres is all of it combined, roughly?
Couldn't tell you.
Any idea? Any ballpark?
Nope. Sorry. I wasn't here when it was built, so I just kind of inherited it and ran with it. So my apologies.
Any more questions?
Okay. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Chief.
Also, I've got our Fire Marshal John Payne come up and just briefly talk about the needs for the fire services and other emergency services here in the county.
Chairman, Commissioners, I'm going to date myself here. I'm going to go back about 40 years. When I was a young boy, I rode my father up to a CB radio meeting. It was a house where Walmart sitting now on Huff Mill Road. It was a house in front. Further back off the road, there was another house. They had a meeting back there. I don't know if it was once a month or once a week, but I would go up there because my prize was getting a Coke out of that little machine. So on the way back, before seatbelt, Sheriff, we sat on the hump in the car. And I looked out coming by exit 148, and I asked my dad, I said, what is going on out there? They had a training ground. It was a training tower. It was a gas line. It was an old fuselage of an airplane that burned one night. And I said, what are they doing? They're training the firemen of the county. With the construction of the restaurant, the construction of the maintenance facility, that was done away with. So the firemen in the county do not have nowhere to adequately train. I brought in, they talked about going and leaving the county, going to different schools. New Hanover County runs a couple schools a year. My two boys are actually going in April. I looked over this weekend, there's 51 classes here that we could teach here in Alamance County to bring people here. If we had the facility, the classroom, the driving pad, the tower and all. So we could definitely use this. Fire departments are mandated by the state to receive 36 hours training per year. A lot of fire departments increased that to 48. On your volunteers, that's a struggle to get you training. So a lot of them will do travel outside to get training on weekends to fulfill that need. So I would hope that y'all will allow the sheriff and the upper management to move forward with at least investigating this opportunity.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, John. Very much.
I have another chief here, Chief Pritchard. Would you like to say anything? Chief Caldwell from Evan. Okay. This time
Chief Parker over there too.
Cliff Parker.
He slid in.
Cliff Parker over here. Yeah. Anything you'd like to say, Clifford?
Doing a good job, sir.
This time I'd like to call Dr. Alex Gatewood, president of our college up. They do a wonderful job in trying to supply our needs, but they're also, there's only so much they can do with the facilities they have, but they do a wonderful job, law enforcement and emergency management. Dr. Gatewood.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, Mr. County Manager, thank you for allowing me to be present this morning to support all of those comments that you've just heard regarding this training center. As Alamance Community College leader, it's imperative that I do everything within the resources available to ensure that we have credible, high-quality training services available for our fire protection officers, for our police officers, for our emergency services personnel. Someone mentioned the cost of lawsuits and those kinds of things. And that person is exactly correct. Training undergirds safety, no pun intended. But the more training we provide, the better prepared our people are to carry out their daily duties and to ensure not only that they are safe, but the people in which they encounter are also safe. We provide, and this is incredible, we can't meet the demands presently in these three areas: fire protection, fire science, police and law enforcement, emergency services overall. Last year we had some 10,000 registrants, 5,000 in basic law and police training alone. Not only is it difficult for us to meet the demand, when we can meet the demand, we have to provide our training facilities that are not really conducive to teaching and learning. So how can we prepare people for 21st century services in the areas just mentioned with 20th century facilities? How can we prepare people adequately when often we don't have the space or it's subject to be moved or not be available depending upon what the activity might be on a given day? And then there's a piece that I think goes beyond what we've talked about to this point, and that is how can we really enhance our training and add things that we aren't doing? How can we have a very robust emergency management type of training where we bring all of these various entities that are in this room now together and practice a major event? And if we are and live long enough, we'll be exposed to some major event. I want to be ready. I think you would like to be ready as well. I'm sure our officers and our emergency services personnel truly wants to be ready so that we can do a good job and again protect our people. It's not a lot more that I can add, except again, let me close by saying it is imperative that we have quality facilities so that we cannot come close to meeting the expectations that are before us, but we can exceed expectations. Thank you very much.
Can I ask a question?
Yes,
on
sir.
The personnel the community college is going to, you know, be a part. Who pays for that? The state?
That is primarily the state, sir.
Mm-hmm.
As Mr. Saunders explained earlier, the way the FTE, full-time equivalency, and the budget reimbursement works, the number of students that we train generates X number of dollars, and then we're able to use those dollars to support personnel.
Dr. Gatewood, I had a few questions. Many of us are familiar with going to the School of Government in Chapel Hill for training for, you know, lawyers or county managers or commissioners, other and judges. They do training there for them. Is there an equivalent training model to the School of Government? Is there an equivalent model to that in the community college system? Could this be an opportunity for Alamance County to kind of take a lead in providing training on a School of Government model for municipal type services?
I would say, let me answer the last part of that question first, and then I'll ask Gary Saunders to address the first part of the question. So Gary, you have time to think about the answer. But yes, it would give Alamance County the opportunity to be in the forefront in terms of leadership and to build a training center and training opportunities that obviously, and the sheriff is correct, it would be regional. I believe we would be a tremendous draw because of what is in this plan once it fully self-actualizes. And I can envision people coming from all over the state of North Carolina to participate in this training. Mr. Saunders, would you like to answer the first part about what is already in this state?
When you're talking about school for the government. I'm aware that, and honestly do not know if the colleges teach that, but I will promise you this. I've always said I will teach you anything that's legal and ethical. I'll teach you anything for anybody, okay?
Okay, thank you, Mr.
So I will check into that and see if we can offer that.
So I think Mr. Saunders is saying, I'm going to extrapolate from what he just said, and the answer to the first question is no. A major training center similar to the School of Government does apparently not exist in this state right now.
I got a question. Maybe Steve Faust can answer, because I think you teach basic law enforcement at the school. Where do you do your training now?
We do the classroom portion at the college.
Okay.
We got one room down there. It's overbooked.
And what about outside firearm training?
Firearms, we go to Bob's Ranch, Sheriff's Department's Ranch.
So you're going to be out of business,
yes,
if the state makes a quick sale, basically, is what we're looking at.
We do driving at Burleson's Ranch.
Okay.
You really have to book it 8-9 months in advance, even get on the books.
Okay, I didn't mean to throw something on you, Dr. Gatewood,
no,
that you wasn't expecting.
But logistically, it doesn't work well.
And I see this, just from its location, is very close to the community college, which I think is definitely a very high priority place to put something if you're going to be using community college to help in the training. Yes.
I think Amy's idea is a good one, too. That, you know, we're not that far away from the school of government. This could be that central resource for the school government to broaden their offerings to government.
Well, I wasn't government really, let me clarify, I wasn't offering that we would supplant what the school of government does or work conjoined with that, but on that model, but
that
on
model,
a different, for a different audience, for people of different kind of classroom needs. I mean, the school of government, I'd be really fond if they tried to open up a firing range in Chapel Hill. That would be pretty interesting. Just different kind of needs met by Alamance County.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Gatewood.
Thank you
very much.
Well, I'd like to say that since serving on this board, I've been real impressed with the law enforcement services and public safety services that we have in this community, as I've gotten to know everybody. And Chief Parrish, I appreciate you mentioning stepping up. That's just a great example of the collaboration that we have. Mr. Saunders, you're absolutely right. This community, I hear all the time, throughout my whole career here, people from the outside coming to Alamance County for one reason or another and commenting about what a great collaborative community that we have. So this is something that we should look into further.
Sheriff, do you have more to add to this? I got one question for you. Being in the real estate world, what's this lease going to cost? And for how long?
We've received a preliminary copy of the lease from Martin Marietta.
Okay.
And, they do have a dollar figure associated with it. It's several thousand dollars per year. But if the board is interested in proceeding with this, that's something we would want to get with the college.
To solidify.
And drill down exactly what it would be. But it was not a free lease, but it's looking to be less than $5,000 a year.
Okay, and in terms of that lease, what are we, maybe Clyde could answer, what would we expect on that?
The original lease terms were for 10 years, but we have not gotten into review or negotiation.
Okay. And where we came up with that dollar figure is that is the amount that they pay in property taxes. So they wanted to kind
of
have that as a wash as far as what they work with us.
And let me say to the commissioners also that federal drug asset seizure monies can be used for the training stuff with
that.
And I can tell you right now, I believe so much that we need the best training that I would try to see that lease is paid through federal drug
and
seizure.
Can that forfeiture money be used towards capital improvements?
Sure can. It can be used to anything involving law enforcement training.
So, I mean, that is an option of funding it.
Okay. Well, at the end of the lease, I mean, improved property, what do you think the real estate value would, if they called for us to buy it, what do you think that might come to?
That's one thing we need to negotiate with the lease. It doesn't address what happens to improvements that are made on it. Not that I've seen that we make. That's something we would want to address with them. Because right now, especially in the phase one part the sheriff's department's talking about, the improvements are the range and the pads, not a tremendous building or any enclosed structure. So But we want to make sure that was clear with Martin Marietta before we signed.
Right. Well, I would assume at the end of the lease, they could come back and say, you got to buy it.
And we should have first right of refusal anyhow.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
And that's how many acres is it closed in?
I believe it's close to 90 acres.
What's 90 acres roughly in raw land, rural land running in this county? You have any idea?
Being raw, rock quarry. You mean
price. Well, I said improved once it's approved.
Yeah.
With water and sewer availability, that would make it cost significantly more.
Right. But sure. The development part of that, I don't know.
Yeah, and also we have to remember this is an old mine. This is, an old mine, and as far as the development, there's not a lot of other you can do on that site. So.
Right. Yeah, once it's been mined, it's not a potential to build houses.
What other local facilities are there? Like, what's Guilford County use? What does Guilford County have?
Of course, they had the old farmer, but they do most of theirs through GC, Guilford Technical College, or they send their people to Davidson County Community College, or and play sort of like what we do. A lot of our people have, I've got several places that I can go over here that we've sent people. Atlantic Beach, Raleigh, Las Vegas, Davis Community College, Myrtle Beach, Guilford Technical College, Salemburg, Edneyville, Wake Tech, Durham PD, very few
things. Is the one in Guilford, is that over by Ragsdale High School, over by Sedgefield Country Club?
They have a campus, Jamestown campus,
right,
for Guilford College, yes, sir.
And that's where they do theirs.
They do a lot of training. I don't know everywhere they go, but I can.
Yeah, it's kind of, it's not a level lot. I go by it all the time.
Okay.
And it's kind of a slanted lot, it looks like to me. It's got towers on it. And be honest, I'm just going to be honest about it. I've never seen anybody using a blasted thing. Now, I'm sure they go over there, and I'm not saying that as a negativity on this issue here or our opportunity, but I've never seen them use it. And I go by there day and night. I don't know when they're using it.
Now, they have a separate shooting range off of Guilford Farm, right?
Yes, sir.
There.
Mm-hmm.
I've been
they do.
That.
Yeah.
Don't know the one you're talking about in Guilford. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Any more questions?
I'd just like to ask the commissioners consider to allow a vote to allow us to move forward to see what we can do, what it will cost not to build, but be able to look at some legitimate facts that we need to deal with.
And the final construction costs, any expenditures would have to come back from the board. And what this is looking for is just getting your approval to move forward with the concept.
I'll make that motion. We move forward.
We vote.
We have to have a motion and a second, and then we have discussion, right?
Yeah. I don't. Well, Robert's rules of order, I think we decided not to do that.
Well,
I think that's how we do that.
Go ahead and do what you want to do there, but I want to ask a question.
Okay, I'll leave it open for that, Tim. Do I hear a second?
Bill's
motion. Thank you, Amy. Okay, yeah, now I'll open it up for questions.
All right. Washington would be proud of us. I know this isn't a public hearing, but I got calls this morning of people that had expressed some concern about this that couldn't come, and I was very disappointed. I said, look, I wish you'd have been here. And there's, I think, can we ask if there's anybody from Green Level that would like to talk about this?
Certainly.
Before we?
I feel that would be appropriate. If there's, I will open the floor up if there's anyone else other than Michael that would like to talk about it. We already heard his side of it.
So. I can go again now.
Yes, sir. Step up and give me your name and yes.
My name is Ahmed Young, and this is pretty much directly in my backyard.
Okay.
And I've got two small children, and I work third shift, so for me, I don't want to hear gunshots all day or all night, and I most certainly don't want anything coming towards my house.
Right.
And also, think about noise levels and, when you're asking what's acceptable, I don't think there's a, is it okay or isn't it okay? I think it needs to be tested. And, I work in a loud environment and we test that thing. So we can say what's acceptable for where I live and what would I be willing to accept? And you could get an independent contractor to put that to the test and say, how loud would it be where they're firing or doing things that they're doing over there? And will that be acceptable for the residents that live in the vicinity?
Okay. Very good. Thank you for that input, and we'll certainly think of that. Yes, sir. Did you want to speak?
think it's just the noise there. We are really having a lot of noise.
Okay.
The blasting. And then we hear it from the fit pin farm, a lot of blasting. And I think that
I'm assuming this blasting will cease once they do what they're doing. Is that correct? Or maybe I'm
not sure.
And Mr. Chairman, that's something that I think part of the due diligence moving forward is we need to address the noise issue and how that will be addressed and the timing and those type details that we don't have at this point. So we will make sure that once moving forward that we try to get the right people in to look at decibel levels and those type of things to make sure that the residents fully understand what they, you know, what green level would be involved in.
Well, I know I get several calls every so often about folks that are shooting in somebody else's backyard, and
right.
Then we have to deal with those issues. But I do know that the sheriff, they're going to have to do the berm and all that to promote the safety right. side of this thing. That's just part of doing what you do.
As far as that berm, heightening those berms going to cut down tremendously on gunshot.
The travel of the sound. Okay.
And, you know, it won't be anything like the plastic down there, I can tell you that. That's
do they still use that to for mining?
Are they blasting now?
One section way off to the left, yes, sir.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So I have a question. How long is it going to take to figure out all the details and, you know, do the sound studies or evaluations? And when would you expect this to be operationalized if there weren't any major hurdles?
But it's not. you're probably looking at a year.
For phase one.
Right.
Yeah. Well, we have to start looking at construction drawings. We have to go through green level and get their permit. We'll have to, you know, that way you will see exactly how much we added to the berm and those type. And
the where detail part of
it. We'll make sure that there's a you know, professional person looking at the gun range, looking at the houses behind to make sure all the safety measures have been taken care of. So there's still a lot of due diligence to do to this project. Basically what you have now is when we worked with Withers and Ravenel, we said, hey, can this work on this site? Does the environmental work? Is there water and sewer closed? Will it lay out to what we think we need at this point? And when they did their layout, they said, yeah, it'll work. So now we have a preliminary master plan. Now we need to get a lot more detailed and further about exacts.
Yes, sir.
That we don't have.
Okay. All right.
One more question. And forgive me about parliamentary procedure, but to make first and seconds without having all the questions answered, I think is improper or uninformed. I understand we paid roughly $10,000 for that. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Was it 10 on the dot?
It's close to it. I don't have that exact dollar figure.
Okay. Who paid for it?
It came out of the sheriff's budget. Part of it was his performance money as well.
How much did we pay for it?
Sir?
How much did we pay for that?
Right at $10,000. Okay. I don't know the exact figure.
To the pen.
I can call and get it for you.
Yeah, for a drawing. Forgive me, I think that's excessive cost for such a simple.
There's a lot of research.
I understand that, but it's not $10,000 worth. How much is the next level going to cost us, do you think?
We do not have that. That would have to, we can bring that back to the board for approval to work with Withers and Ravenel and get a scope of work.
Which is going to them to get a preliminary right. estimate right. of the work that needs to be done, preliminary to the preliminary, basically.
Well, I just want to say that Blue Lives Matter yeah. to the citizens of Alamance County. You know, I have a family friend lives out near us, and he's retired from the Marine Corps and serves with the Sheriff's Department now, and he has two little children and a wife, and we just owe him and his family the best training possible to be sure that he comes home every day, because he's out there not really doing it for the paycheck. He's doing it because he's a server, and he is actually in green level quite a bit and works to keep people safe. And we owe it to those professionals to make sure that they have the training, to make sure that they have the equipment and all the kind of tools to be sure that they are safe. Also, well-trained emergency services is a blessing, not only to that professional and to his family, but also to the community, because we really depend on their wisdom and experience. I'm sure that those of us who haven't done these jobs don't really understand or appreciate the split-second decisions that have to be made that impact many people for the rest of their lives, not only the citizen that the law enforcement officer is encountering, but also the citizen's family, their friends, the law enforcement officer's family and friends. And Chief Smythe and Dr. Gabe Wood spoke to the cost of the lawsuits that can be prevented. I think yes. That's a very compelling argument. I would like to see sort of an exploration of the idea of having a municipal services training academy type thing on a school of government model that's parallel to that, not sort of swooped into the school of government, but parallel to the school of government, where we're a leader in the state of North Carolina and even the Southeast in making sure that our professionals are well-trained, well-equipped, because it ends up saving a lot of money in the long run, and also it's the right thing to do for people.
Well, I know as a board, we spend money very often to send our officers and firemen to training across the state and sometimes out of the state because of the lack of the opportunities. I think in the long run, I can see this actually saving us some money because of the fact that, number one, we're bringing some sales tax dollars in because people have to stay here when they come here to do their training over several days. That, to me, is an economic incentive to look at that would benefit the level, green level, and the whole community here. And I'm going to say I'm all for it, and I look forward, and like the sheriff said, or Ron said, I think if you build it, they will come. And I think that's something that's a good thing.
So part of the analysis is that we need to look at the money that we save on spending to send people off to training, and then the money that we generate as a result of bringing people in.
Exactly what will this bind us to do? We approve this vote.
This is to go out and find a firm, whether Ravenel or whoever it is that's been doing it, to actually come back with a proposal to this board.
What it's going to cost us?
Of the cost to draw enough to start possible construction and to be able to bid on, because without exact details, nobody will bid on it. And
will it be just an estimate of the first phase or the whole deal?
They can break it down in various phases.
As one total project, but also looking at what each phase would cost as well. And you know, that would be called looking at grading, look at the whole nine yards, looking at water and sewer.
Right.
The other thing that I think this also does is for you giving your acceptance of this, we can start looking at outside funding. Then the sheriff can go to the governor's crime commission, he can go to our legislature and say, we are looking at this as a project for Alamance County. Do you have dollars that can help us, or that we carried in front of the board? Board has given us their blessing to move forward. Not that we were doing it, but to move forward and saying that we think this is a valuable asset for our county.
But we'll be asking for the total.
Yes, sir.
With this vote.
Yes.
Well, as an estimate.
Yes, sir.
All right.
We're just asking the company.
Right. You're not committing funding from the county. We're not committing
of doing
ACC. We're not committing anything. This is the next step.
Okay. All right. We do have a motion and a second on the floor. Ask for a vote. All in favor, voice of aye.
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 All opposed, hearing none. Sheriff, you're going to have to get busy.
Thank y'all very much.
If you guys would like to leave, you're welcome to. I know y'all have places y'all need to be to keep your local municipality safe. So. Thank you all.
people up here that didn't want it. They just didn't speak. They're not here in support of it, I'll assure you.
You gotta say what they got to say, you know.
It's gonna run you about $4 million probably. I would say.
It's depending on the buildings they put, but pads and a shooting range probably.
Guarantee you, we're going to have to get halfway down the road, or third down the road, but come back and say, I can't get to the
All right, next on our agenda is proclamation for National Literacy Action Week. And I'm going to just read a statement here. Being able to read is an essential tool that affects everything within our county, from economic development to the health care system. It is important to recognize the efforts that are in place to promote literacy within Alamance County and understand being literate is essential to the safety and well-being of every citizen. And with that, I would like to ask MJ to come forward. And Tori, have you got that? She's got it.
Yeah, right here.
We'll see.
Are you going to read it or I'm...
Either one. Doesn't matter. Would you like me to read it?
You read it. That's good.
Whereas more than 1 million adults in North Carolina experience reading and writing difficulties that seriously affect their daily lives and that of their families, in Alamance County, approximately 1 in 5 people lack a high school diploma. 13% of citizens in Alamance County lack basic literacy skills, 1% above the state average of 12%. And whereas 80% of the fastest growing jobs in the United States require some post-secondary education, more than 40% of the United States workforce and more than 50% of high school graduates do not have required basic literacy skills for employment. And whereas studies indicate that healthcare costs for adults with low literacy skills, a cost of $21,760, are 4 times higher than the national average of $5,440. Individuals with low literacy skills have a higher rate of hospitalization and increased incidence of medication and treatment errors than the general public. The healthcare industry estimates that $73 billion per year of unnecessary healthcare expense is attributable to poor literacy. And whereas literacy organizations throughout the state and in Alamance County offer critical support in improving the lives of our citizens through education, increasing the quantity and quality of literacy programming, as well as work and life skills training to give all Alamance County citizens the opportunity to reach their full potential, thereby creating a strong workforce and healthy state and local economy. Now, therefore, let it be known to all present that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners hereby proclaim February 1st through 8th, 2017, as National Literacy Action Week in Alamance County.
And Jay, I just want to thank you for the hard work you do at our library. I know we stole one of your best workers back there with Michelle, but anyhow, thank you very much on behalf of the commissioners for your work and keeping Alamance County literate.
We're working.
Very good.
Thank you.
As a member of MJ's advisory committee, I echo Eddie's remarks about the great work that they do.
All right. Next up, we're going to discuss, have a little financial update. Looks like Susan's ready to go.
Good morning, commissioners. My presentation will be very brief this morning. Here's your 6 month financial update. As you can see from where we were at, and I apologize for the September 30th date, that should be December 31st, that last save did not take. But we have an adopted budget, this change of 4.14% over what was adopted at 42.3 million. We are now at 148.2 million. On the next slide, you can see our revenue for 16-17 fiscal year. We've collected 57% of our budget compared to 58% in the previous year. And we are seeing an increase of 0.9% in our revenues. One that I would like to point out is the investment earnings. As the Federal Reserve is increasing those percentage points in investments, the county is seeing a return on those investments as well. For expenditures, we are exactly where we were percentage-wise this year compared to last year at 46%. We have spent less than 50% of our budget as of December 31st, with total expenses actually of $68.1 million as compared to $64.6 million the previous year, with a percentage change of 5.5%.
Any questions?
You can't give us an estimate of our fund balance.
I was getting ready to ask the same question.
Our audit has gone to the LGC, and we are waiting for approval of there. We are adding to our fund balance this year of $7.8 million. Where part of that is coming from, though, is we had $2 million in encumbrances that have rolled forward from the previous year to this current year. So we have to take that into account. So when you take that out, we're adding about 5.3 to our fund balance.
As of what? When?
As of June 30th, 2016.
So you don't have a sense about where it is as of, say, December 31st?
Not yet, because the reason for that, Commissioner Byrd, is with the funds moving, you have revenues coming in and expenditures coming out. A county cannot recognize that full net income of revenues over expenses until everything has been settled and our accruals are posted for the year. So we always have that at June 30th.
So we'll know that pretty soon, that,
yes,
that number?
Yes.
Why did it take 6 months for that figure to be known?
Well, we had to do an audit contract amendment to ours. There were some additional guidances that came down from the state auditor's office this year for compliance that delayed our auditors getting all the information that they needed. Plus, two, the DSS confirmations coming from the state were later coming out this year than in previous years.
What percentage were we quoting at the end of the fiscal year?
Let me grab that figure. It's over here.
I am curious about it. See, we had $4 million pop in before I left the board. We had no offense, county management sat here and said that, we were only going to get about $800,000 increase. We raised taxes. I didn't vote for it. Raised taxes 2 cents because of what we thought the fund balance was being minimized. And then we had $4 million come in, kind of like I think what this $6 million figures in the same mode. And then I remember David Smith, just to be blunt about it, he said, and he was the one that voted for the tax increase. Bill and I voted against it. It passed 3-2. And then David said, well, if I'd have known that we was going to get $4 million in the way, it appears that we're getting this, I would have never voted for the 2 cent tax increase. And then we voted to recut taxes 1 penny to kind of get it back down. But that's the history of that. I mean, it appears that this happens every year, maybe not to this extent.
Right.
But I remember the $4 million was.
And where we're seeing an increase this year, Commissioner Sutton, is through our property tax. Not necessarily the rate increase, but we were able to collect with new businesses coming online, new property listed. Our housing market has gotten stronger in the county, and we saw an increase there of about $3 million collected more than was budgeted. Plus, two, the general statute, when you're budgeting for how much you're going to collect in a fiscal year, you're limited to the collection rate from the previous audit year. So Jeremy and his staff do an excellent job of each year pushing that collection rate higher and higher. So that will enable us this year to budget even more when it comes to our property tax. Another strong area that we're seeing an increase is in our sales tax. As the economy has gotten stronger, consumers are more comfortable with spending their money versus I've got to hold on to it to get through the tough times, because we have come out of that recession. And it's just one of those trends in our economic development here in Alamance County. As consumers are more comfortable with spending, you see a higher increase in that sales tax. And through the recession years, we had to cut our funding there by over $6 million. And so as we're currently seeing that increase come about, we are now getting back to the levels that we were prior to the recession in 2009. So our economy is getting stronger within the county. Where it looks like that, question, Commissioner Byrd, is that our unassigned fund balance is 22.7% compared to 20.16% where we were at this point in time last fiscal year for 15 and 16.
And we set a goal of 25%.
Correct.
And in the counties of our size and our size group average, it was at 26%. Do you know if that's been updated?
The state has not updated those figures yet, but as soon as they do, I can bring them for you.
So I think that's the main indicator of financial strength, really. And I think it's important to be financially strong so that we have a good bond rating and keeps our interest rates down, especially if we're being faced with a major bond for the school system.
So this $6 million, how much did you say it was, six?
We're going to add, when you take out for the encumbrances that we have for this current year that rolled forward, we're looking at about 5.8.
Okay. So is that going to be on top of the 22.7, or is that included?
That's included within that.
That's included.
Yes, sir.
That's well, one comment
within.
About the averages other counties have, I would say to you that the majority of the counties that have those tremendously large fund balances over the 8% suggested by the state is a result of excessive taxation. And we'll talk about that later. When is the budget process going to start?
It started now with department heads' budget calendar. They're getting the budget sheets have gone out. We just approved the schedule last week, and I will email that to the board now. So very similar to what we've done in years past, but right now budget sheets have been sent to department heads. But we'll get you the actual schedule today.
I think that 8% is really a, like the absolute minimum that the
state requires. No, it's suggested. It's suggested. Really? Yeah. Yeah, need to check into it.
Yeah, that's fine. But we should go under that, they come in, right?
Well, they'd know. They just write you a letter like they did one time before, and that's when we had the 800,000 prediction, and it came in at 4 million, and yeah. We went from the 8 below 8 to
22 million.
Well, I'm talking about percentile. Okay. 23% in 2 years, roughly 2 years, 2 to 3 years. And I just, you know, that's excessive packing in of the fund balance, in my opinion. You have all kind of games played with this. Bob, we went down to Davidson County. This is when we had our initial meeting with them over performance-based budgeting. That's where we Tim Burgess and I went down on that, and that's what we brought back, was performance-based budgeting. But they had gone through a reevaluation, and they didn't lower their tax rate at all. And that's what ballooned theirs up. They had reevaluation after 8 years, and I'm pretty sure it was 8 years, and they didn't lower their, they didn't go to revenue neutral,
right.
Let's put it that way. And I just looked at the assistant county manager, and I said, you know, how'd you pull that off? And he just looked at me and grinned. And I said, they'd burn our courthouse down if we'd pulled that trick. But anyway, that's...
They didn't burn Burlington's down. They pulled that on you, didn't they, Tim?
What was that? Now?
They didn't burn Burlington's down.
I don't know.
They didn't change theirs revenue neutral.
Well, somebody should have raised H over. There's all kind of games with these figures. And I couldn't care less what other counties are doing, as long as we're fiscally sound, and I think we are. More than not.
Well, I agree with you. The important concept is to be fiscally sound.
Yeah, and we are.
Thank you, Susan. All right, next we have a budget amendment from our recreation, two budget amendments from our recreation and parks.
Good morning, Commissioner.
Morning.
I do have two budget amendments for you today. The first is to accept funds from the state in the amount of $640,000, $550,000. These will be for the acquisition of some property on Cane Creek Mountains, part of a significant natural heritage area that we have in the southern part of the county. There are no county funds required for this. It's just accepting a grant we were awarded by the state of North Carolina.
How is it that we purchased that property for so far under the appraised value?
The owner of that property was generous and gave us a good deal. That's the answer.
All right.
Yeah. So you can buy that piece of property for, what is that?
$650,000.
Yep, $640,000.
$40,000.
Man, what a deal.
It is. It's a
real
deal.
Do you need a motion?
Yes,
I make a motion. We do that.
I second it.
All right. Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Now,
The second budget amendment is to create a fund of $20,000 to allow us to run a reimbursement program with Special Olympics North Carolina. For our Special Olympics coordinator, we will spend money out of this county account. It'll be fully reimbursed by Special Olympics. It just allows us to put in place the fiscal controls that we have in the county system in the expenditure of that money that will be fully reimbursed by Special Olympics.
I move we approve that.
Second. Thank you, Bill. Bob. All right. All in favor of that?
Aye.
Thank you.
Let me ask you something. Since I've been on the recreation and boards again,
yes.
Before y'all meet,
welcome. We move it around.
Cedar Rocks.
Before
y'all meet tomorrow night.
No, tonight.
I need to be there.
We're not tomorrow night. We're the third Tuesday.
Sure, okay.
So I will send you a schedule.
Okay.
Sure.
They go to Cedar Rock. They go to all the various parks in
y'all
the county.
Go to meet. Okay.
Yeah, we like to
good
work
idea.
At our different places.
When the spring idea. Weather allows it.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay. Department of Social Service. Ms. Osborne, good morning.
Good morning. This is real quick. We are a pass-through for Piedmont Natural Gas Share the Warmth. We get allocations when they collect the funds from their customers. So we have an additional $862 to put in our energy assistance for Share the Warmth.
Very good. How much have you spent this year on that? Do you have any idea on the total?
That we've spent on energy, it's well over 200,000.
Wow. All right.
And we're still seeing folks every day. We still have some funds.
Yeah.
Some federal funds.
Good. All right.
Do you help on a percentile basis people who don't use Piedmont gas percentage-wise?
Oh, yes. The majority, right. This is just a small pot. We have our federal funds, low-income energy assistance, and the crisis intervention program. And by far, the majority is Duke Power.
Yeah.
But we also do, you know, we buy wood. We put oil in, kerosene, oil, all of the heating
right.
methods.
It's not particular any form of heat.
No. Mm-hmm,
okay.
No.
All right. I'll take a motion to accept this.
So moved.
Thank you, Bill.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
Very good. Okay, next we have an amendment for Soil and Water Administration. Hey, Brad.
Good morning.
How you doing?
Good
morning.
For those who do not know me, my name is Brad Moore. I'm the department head for the Soil and Water Conservation District, and I'm here speaking on behalf of the Voluntary Agriculture District this morning. And I'm pleased to be here before you to give you an update on the VAD moving forward with preserving farmland here in the county. As you can see before you, we've been working on a project to permanently preserve 75 acres in the southern end of the county. Sometime back we did receive some funding from the state grant that is matching the funds that the county is to provide, and that is what I'm here to ask your support of this morning. The Voluntary Ag District has approved that $102,713 be used from the County Farmland Preservation Fund, and again this is a match to a grant that we have received by the state. Basically, the state will send reimbursements to the county for that amount of the $102,000. Plus, they also some closing costs is involved, as well as some survey costs. So, total reimbursements will be around $112,000. I just become coming before you this morning to ask for your support.
Okay. Any questions to that? How that's going about? I think you are you the board chair this year, Bill?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Bill Miller. Good to see you this morning. All right. I'll entertain a motion if there's.
Well, I'll move approval. I've been going to those meetings, and this particular piece of property has been talked about for some time, and it's been very thoroughly vetted, and it's, you know, it's one of our pillars in our new plan of preserving agriculture, and this fits right in. And this is money that's already been set aside.
Yes, sir. The county for some time has been setting aside funding for these types of purchases.
You know, Amy's been going to these meetings too since she's been elected. And And Eddie, you've been to...
Right, yeah. And a question on that, what will be left in that balance once we do this?
If I'm not mistaken, there's roughly $221,000.
See.
And we will be taking out roughly $102,000.
Do you foresee the state coming up with this matching money as we move forward? I know the legislation deals with that.
That is something that's always variable. The program is still in place. There's been good years and bad years.
Right.
We always submit applications to the state for this program, but we're always not selected. This is something, obviously, that is something that's a good thing when we are selected and to be able to match this type of funding. It's not that the county cannot preserve farms on its own, but obviously it'd have a higher price tag.
Right. Okay.
Well, do we have a second to the motion yet? I'd second the motion and say that preserving farmland is just a critical need in the state of North Carolina and Alamance County with all the development that we see going on all around us. And when we have a property owner who volunteers to take that money, take their real property out of the development realm, I think it's a really wise use of resources, and so I second the motion.
All right. Thank you, Amy. Tim, any comments? Okay. Well, I know you guys have done a great job with this, and the state looks to you guys sometimes how to write these programs and how to make them work. So with that, we've got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? None. Okay. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
All right, County Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and Board. The only thing I really want to mention today is we were looking at restarting the spring part of County Government 101. This will be an evening session. We will take about 15 citizens, so we will put that on the website to sign up. But we'll begin that March 7th at 5:30 here in the Commissioner's Chambers. Six, excuse me. Thank you, Tori. Appreciate Tori, the work she's done in helping getting all that together. But again, we will go and we will go to DSS, we will go to the landfill, all of emergency services, CCOM, you name it. So to give our citizens a better understanding about what we do as county government. So that March 6th at 5:30. So if you know anybody that's interested, let Tori know. Tori is kind of our coordinator on that, but we'll also place the application on the website as well.
Very good.
And that's all I have at this time.
All right. I would like to make a motion that we go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143-31811A6 to consider the qualifications and conditions of an initial employment of a present employee.
Second.
Thank you, Bill. All in favor of that?
Aye.
Aye. And we will go into closed session. I would like to make a motion that we go back into open session.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor of that?
Aye. Aye.
In our closed session, the board has agreed to accept Brian Haygood as our interim manager, and Brian actually agreed to it, so which is a good thing. And moving forward, we will work the details out to that and work with Sherry and so forth on pay and so forth on how we move forward. So with that said, get back on our agenda. I think we have commissioner comments, if we have any.
I'd like to start out and say welcome to Brian. He has been an asset to this county. I remember when he came and started to work for the Recreation and Parks, and he has background of a Marine training, and he's going to make a good manager.
So he's going to whip us into shape.
That's absolutely right. Good choice.
Very good. Very good. I think we have too, and I look forward to working with Brian moving forward. Craig, thank you for your services, and best of luck. Where
you
got?
He trained him well.
He was already trained. He is. You could not have made a better choice. And I have enjoyed the last 5-6 years of working with Brian on a daily basis. I always say it was not that he was the assistant manager. he was kind of the co-manager, because if there was a decision that needed to be made, if I didn't have Brian Haygood's opinion on what we needed to do moving forward, usually I would not make that decision. So I trust and value him. He is as good a family man, he is as good a Christian, he is as good a manager as you'll ever want to meet. And I'm very blessed and lucky to have worked with Brian, and the county is in great hands.
Yep. Okay. Any other comments? Amy?
Just thank Craig for his service to the county. Sorry to see you go. Understand the opportunity that you have down east, and I noticed Brian's blushing when Craig's talking about a little flesh there. But I look forward to working on this journey together.
Yeah. Tim.
Now, Craig's still with us till March.
Yeah, well.
I'll save my goodbyes for another time.
Yeah, we'll save that. But thank you, Craig, for what you've done there, too. All right. No other comments. Meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.